Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. The psalm this morning is Psalm 16. It can be found on page 599 in the Book of Common Prayer. We will read it together. Protect me, O God, for I take refuge in you. I have said to the Lord, you are my Lord, my good above all other. All my delight is upon the godly that are in the land, upon those who are noble among the people. But those who run after other gods shall have their troubles multiplied. Their libations of blood I will not offer, nor take the names of their gods on my lips. O Lord, you are my portion and my cup. It is you who uphold my lot. My boundaries enclose a pleasant land. Indeed, I have a goodly heritage. I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me night after night. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not fall. My heart, therefore, is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. For you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let your Holy One see the pit. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know. This man, handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that though perishable is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of this treasure you found.
A reading from the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the disciples, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
If there is one thing you will learn quickly about me, St. George family, it is that I love the singer and writer Jimmy Buffett. I love all things tropical, warm and sunny beaches, palm trees, surfboards, relaxing music, the laid-back lifestyle. I love it all. A lot of people tease me about that someone who plays jazz would be such a fan of Jimmy Buffett. Two things. First, he has gotten to be a pretty darn good musician over the last 40 years. And two, he is a great writer. It is his lyrics that I first fell in love with. Much of his lesser known stuff is poetic, it's witty, it's sarcastic, and can be beautiful. And one song I have been thinking a lot about lately is a song called "Pre-You." And the story behind the song was that Jimmy was standing in an elevator in San Diego listening to two sailors talk in the 1980s. And one had just returned from his honeymoon, where he had run into his ex-girlfriend on the beach. Well, the other sailor asked, "What did you do?" And the first sailor replied, "Well, after she left, I told my new wife that she was pre-you, and it worked." Pre-you. This phrase got me to thinking about pre-COVID. What was pre-COVID like? What was good about it? What am I missing from 6 weeks ago that I want back and is healthy? What are you missing that was good pre-COVID that you want back and is healthy? What habits will we get back into, and what habits will we leave behind? For example, I was on a Zoom chat with about 10 of my friends from Austin a few weeks ago, and I noticed that just like in the old days, we were all staring at our phones. We were Zooming online, and we were still staring at our phones. Someone pointed it out, and we laughed and put all our phones away and spent time with one another. Have you had the same experience? Is your family actually talking instead of texting because you're now in the same room? Have we thought about what is important, about what is okay to leave in the past, and what we should keep after this crisis has gone? Well, we know what pre-COVID looked like. If we take the time, we can discern what was positive and negative about our pre-COVID lives. And you know what? It is our choice to make as to what the after COVID will look like. And guess what? That's great news. We get to decide what will be important. We get to write our own stories. We get to decide what our relationships will look like. You and I get to decide what our relationships with God will look like. In the midst of this, many have turned to trusting God. Many have refocused their lives back on Jesus. Will we continue to join in live-streamed church services as often? Will we read our Bibles and other spiritual materials as often? Will we pray as often? Are we trusting God and depending on Him right now to get us through? Will we continue to trust God to get us through after COVID? Trust isn't easy. Whether it is God or other people, trust is hard. Are we living in fear right now? Are we staying at home because we are afraid? Or are we staying at home right now because it is the loving thing to do? Will we continue to trust God to get us through? Or after COVID, will we get comfortable and complacent again when we don't need God as much? Trust is hard. The gospel reading this morning deals with the issue of trust. Fear and trust are main elements in this reading. First off, we see the disciples locked in a room for fear of the Jews. There's a trust issue. Jesus shows up and then leaves before Thomas arrives. Thomas walks in and his buddies tell him what happened, and he doesn't believe them. There's another trust issue. Thomas has to sit in his doubt for an entire week before Jesus returns. But one thing about doubt is it is our own doubt that God works through many times to strengthen our faith. Doubt is not a sin. Doubt and faith are not opposites. They coexist. Doubt allows us to intellectually explore our faith. It forces us to go deeper and thus strengthens us in our journeys. So finally, Jesus returns again, and Thomas believes. He jumps from no faith to complete trust in a moment. But think about this act of trust between Jesus and Thomas. Jesus tells him to touch his wounds. Think back to your childhood. When you fell down and scraped your knee, who did you let dress the wound? It was only the person you trusted the most. No one was allowed to touch my scrapes but Mom. It is the ultimate trust on Jesus' part to let Thomas touch his wounds. He allowed himself to be vulnerable before Thomas. So here's my question. In order to trust God, are we waiting for Jesus to come and say, "Put your hands into my wounds"? Read on in the passage, and he answers our request. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. The word blessed in the Greek can mean fortunate or happy. And it is the Christian that is fortunate and happy because of faith in Christ. It is the assurance of trusting that God will get us through. Trust. This is where that peace that passes all understanding comes from. I'm not saying it's easy, but it is available. How do we get it? Well, Jesus is probably not going to show up in the next couple months and let you touch his wounds. This is faith, believing in things we cannot see. It's trust. But what God does so that we may have faith in the midst of doubt is he gives us his word, the Bible. We can explore the people that God used for his glory in spite of their doubt in the past. God also gives us his church, a family for strength and comfort, and he gives us his Holy Spirit. God gives us an opportunity to speak with him one-on-one through prayer, the opportunity to vent and to question, the opportunity to fall and be awed, and the opportunity to request and doubt like Thomas. Jesus stands before us knowing our fears and pain, having been truly man. And he stands before us ready to take our doubts and fears, being truly God. He stands before us with his hands out saying, "Fear not, trust, God will get you through." We know what the pre-COVID life looked like. For many of us, it was filled with fear and busyness and disconnection. But let's plan the after-COVID life with our spiritual life and relationships at the forefront, trusting God as our guide. The past, the pre-COVID, can help us figure out how we got to this turning point, but we will not and should not return to those times. God leads us forward with a promise of new life. And isn't that what Easter is all about? Isn't that what Jesus is all about? Isn't that what we as resurrection people are all about? The promise of new lives in Jesus Christ. After COVID, we can have new life in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Let us say together on page 96, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Well, good morning and welcome all of you to our worship live stream today. We're glad that you're here. If you are new or you're just watching this for the first time, you're kind of new to the St. George community, we welcome you. You should have access to an online guest card. You can fill that out and we can send you some more information about our worship life here and about this community. And we can let you know as things begin to open up for us over the next few weeks, then we can begin to let you know about that. Also, there is a link to Tithely, and so we'd invite you to do that, as well as make an offering during this offertory. Our offertory sentence this morning is from Matthew's Gospel. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary or heavy burdened, and I will refresh you." Enjoy our offertory anthem.
Oh,
And now, as our Lord Jesus taught us to pray, we are bold to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our suffrages. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Govern and uphold them now and always. Day by day we bless you. Praise your name forever. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Have mercy on us, Lord. Have mercy. Lord, show us your love and mercy, for we put our trust in you. In you, Lord, is our hope, and we shall never hope in vain. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. O most mighty and merciful God, in this time of grievous sickness we run to you for help. Deliver us, we pray, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use for their cure. And grant that, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts to that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God of peace, who has taught us that in returning in rest we shall be saved, in quietness and in confidence shall be our strength. By the might of your Spirit, lift us, we pray, to your presence, where we may be still and know that you are God. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hard wood of the cross that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your Spirit, that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you, for the honor of your name. Amen.
We were waiting without hope, without light.
Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
I invite your prayers of intercession and thanksgiving at this time. Gracious God, we offer before you all the prayers that are on our hearts and minds. We offer to you those concerns, those needs that we have and that others have. We offer prayers especially this day for all educators and their students as they deal with the reality that they will not have face-to-face meetings. Ease their grief. Strengthen their resolve. And give them your courage and hope. We pray for all those who are sick, especially for those who have COVID-19. We pray for those who await word on testing. We pray for the hurting, the lonely, the anxious, the fearful. We pray for all those who suffer from addiction or mental health disorders. We pray for all parents of students. We offer our prayers for our civic leaders and for health professionals. We pray for those who are facing unemployment, for those who are on very limited resources, and for those who put themselves in harm's way, especially our medical and health providers, first responders, and all those who stock our grocery shelves and do other essential work that sustains our lives during the pandemic. We also pray for all those who have asked for our prayers, for Father Bruce, Charlotte, Sophie, John, Chris, for Marianne, Patty, for Father Scotty and family, for Bill, Florence, Paul, Ben, Nancy, Susie, Randy and family, Kelly, Karen, Laura, Jeff, Lisa, Joe, Kevin, Bill, Carmelina, Jackie, Orbelia, Bob, and for our leadership and our staff and our wider St. George community. We offer prayers for all who have died, and we pray especially for the repose of the soul of Donnie LeBlanc. And we offer our prayers for those who grieve, especially Debbie and the LeBlanc family. We offer prayers of thanksgiving for the blessings in our lives, and we give thanks that Michael has recovered from COVID-19. And we give thanks for the birthdays of Rosemarie, Sophia, Jody, Ned, Steve, Giselle, Chuck, and Deacon Bill. And we pray for those who have wedding anniversaries, Jim and Meg, Alan and Janie, Glenn and Rhonda, Bruce and Vivian, Scott and Jessica. And we conclude our prayers by saying together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. And together we say, glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to him from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen. And may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you, keep you safe, make you strong this day and every day of your life. Amen. All right, closing song.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Thank you for joining us this morning. The stream team of Reverend Susan and Keith and Shannon Earl and I and Taylor Brown, who's back on the back end there typing in all the comments for us and giving you all the information and forms. We thank you for joining us today and hope that you have a blessed day. And here is a postlude for your enjoyment. Bye-bye, y'all. Take care. See you soon.